God sent his Son. Emmanuel, now behold, incarnate love. A virgin and her child, a Savior meek and mild. The star became the sign. In the fullness of time, prophets long they foretold the promised dawn. Hail God of God, light of light, begotten one, by whom all things were made, there in a manger laid, now born to us this night. In the fullness of time, holy, holy, holy moment, God has come to dwell with us. Glory to the Lamb, the great night divine, in the fullness of time.
Hosts of angels resounded at his birth, and hosts of angels will endless tell his worth, and he shall come again. His kingdom has no end, all things made new, made right, in the fullness of time. Holy, holy, holy moment, God has come to dwell with us. Glory to the Lamb, the great night divine, in the fullness of time.
Glory in the highest, our deliverer. Holy, holy, holy moment, God has come to dwell with us. Glory to the Lamb, the great I Am.
Holy, holy, holy moment, God has come to dwell with us. Glory to the Lamb, the great I Am, who came. In the fullness of time,
to us this night,
in the fullness,
oh, the star became the sun,
in the fullness of time.
Holy, 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 in a manger lowly, Christ the Son, now veiled in flesh, in our humanity.
Kingdoms bow before him, heaven and earth adore him.
Hail His Majesty.
Good afternoon to you. And as always, let me welcome you to our Wednesday relaunch. This is our kind of Christmas special. And we do have a kind of two-week break now. So the next two Wednesdays will not be having the lunch in the middle of the day. And really the reason for that is to give these ladies just a wee bit of a break. They do an amazing job for 50 weeks of the year. And we figure that we should give them a wee break because today's lunch, yeah. Heather and her dream team. So I hope you enjoy it because today's soup, that's really a meal in itself and will keep you going for the rest of the day and beyond. So we're really grateful to you always. Always served with such a smile as well. And this is a kind of seasonal day because Christmas coming up. And so as a kind of starting point today, I thought we might just try running past you some of the kind of all-time great Christmas films, see if you recognize what they are. Okay, we're not going to spend the whole time in this, but here's the first one. Hands up you if you recognize straight off which one that is. Okay, so on the count of three, I want you to shout out which film it is. One, two, three. Home Alone. Absolutely right. Yeah. Okay, we don't need the whole long cast yet. Home Alone is the film there, and that is one of the kind of all-time classics that gets played over and over again at Christmas, partly obviously because it is set at Christmas time, and partly because it's another story that just reminds us of essentially the Christmas message, which is that God has come and he actually handles the bad things in life and in the world, and he puts things right. And the story has a good ending without spoiling. If you've not watched Home Alone, I've spoiled the ending of it, but it has a good ending. And that's really what God means us to understand from the Christmas. He's come in Jesus in order to give to us a good ending. And the key theme in a lot of ways is there in the title. Often we feel alone, and what people are looking for is actually a home. There is a kind of instinct that we have that means home is really important for us. And there is a sense in which very often our celebrations over Christmas, the songs that we sing, the times that we have, remind us that we were made to belong, we were made to be part of a family, made to just to have a home. And it's that home that God means us to have in and through his son. So there's one film. Here's another clue for the next film. We'll put it up for you on the screen. Anyone able to tell me from that, hands up if you think you know, don't shout it out, but if you think you know from that part of the film cover. Okay, so you're not getting it on that. Fair enough. That could be a kind of Red Cross, you know, ambulance or who knows what. But if I fill in a little bit more of the picture, then you may be able to guess what it is. Okay, David, yeah. Absolutely, yes, it is Love, actually, okay? And that's another film, again, set in that sort of context. And people just kind of enjoy that film because at its heart, as the title of the film says, it's really just about love. And it is, we were made not only for home, we were made for love as well. And there's a part of us all through life that is looking for love. We want to give love. We want to enjoy love. We want to be loved. And it's that again. Sometimes one of the carols that we sing at Christmas is Love Came Down at Christmas. Love all lovely, love divine. And it's that we are looking for, longing for, not only a place, but a person, and a person who will love us. And that's what lies behind the Christmas story. Why did Jesus come? It is because God so loved the world. And he means us to understand that far from being fearful of God and wanting to run away from him, our wisdom is actually to go to him and to know his loving arms around us in all our circumstances. The next one is almost certainly the one that comes out top of the all-time Christmas great films. It is indeed, yes. Okay, you got it straight off. It's A Wonderful Life. James Stewart and Donna Reed there. And interestingly, the two of them never never actually figured it in the same film after that, although the chemistry between them in the film, if you ever watched the film, the chemistry between them was remarkable, and people thought they must get on really well, but they never acted it in the same film again, because when that film first came out, it was a flop in the cinemas, and James Stewart blamed Donna Reed for that. And they had a bit of tension after that, and so they kind of never really acted with one another again. But it's lasted the pace, and it is just a remarkable film that is set against a background of Christmas, and it has another wonderful ending. But one of the reasons I put that up is because alongside the need and the longing that we have for a home, and alongside the need and the longing we have for love, ultimately it is life that we are looking for. And in the title of that film again, you have that theme. Home, yes, we're looking for that. And love, actually, yes, we're looking for that. And a life, it's life that we're looking for. And today's classic one-liner, we've been looking at a few one-liners from the lips of Jesus over the course of these past weeks, easily remembered things that Jesus said. It's partly because they are easily remembered that he said these things this way so that you and I would be able to remember them. It's not complicated. We'd be able to remember what he said because what he said is important. And what he said in this particular one-liner really explains Christmas and why we celebrate Christmas as we do, why we make such a fuss about it. It's not just because we quite enjoy a party, not just because we quite like turkey soup and mince pies or whatever. We celebrate as we do because something quite remarkable happened. In the coming of Jesus into this world, he was coming with a real intent to do us good. And he described it in these terms. He said, "I have come that you may have life and have it to the full." And there you have the explanation that he gives for Christmas. That's why he came. That's why he was born. "I've come," he said, "that they may have life and have it to the full." And that means it's you and me. He means that we should enjoy not just a kind of existence, but we should have a very real life. And that fullness of life is something that the Bible, the rest of the Bible, kind of spells out for us to help us understand, what does this life look like? What does it feel like? Why is it such a special thing, this life that he comes to give to us, that fullness of life? And very often I put it like this, that there are these kind of four compass points, north, south, east, and west, about that life that help us understand why it is such a wonderful thing that we're able to enjoy a new life that he and he alone gives. And those four things are, first of all, it's a life that is full of purpose. There is a clear direction. We're not just kind of drifting from one day to another through life. We now have a clear purpose. There is something that we are applying our energies and our time to, something that we are giving ourselves to, and it is purposeful. And we are looking for that in our lives, looking that our lives should have significance, our lives should have purpose, that they should have a lasting significance in the world in which we live. So that's the first thing. It's a life that is marked by a clear purpose. We are now sharing with something that God himself is doing in the world day by day. We got to be a part of that. And that all of a sudden makes life rather different. Second component of that life is power. We no longer simply live out life in our own strength, applying all our energies. We're able to draw on his power. And one of the reasons the New Testament, the part of the Bible that speaks about the life and the ministry of Jesus, is so full of what he did is so that we can understand when we have him in our lives, all sorts of things start to happen. He does amazing things. And he comes and he gives to us a power that is not our own, so that our lives no longer are lived in our strength, but with his strength and in his power as well. That's the second thing. So it's a life that has purpose, a life that has power, a life, thirdly, that is full of pleasure. Often people think that somehow Jesus must make life dull and boring, and that he kills any sense of joy. The very opposite is actually the case. It's just a total contradiction to suggest that Jesus somehow doesn't mean that we should enjoy life. It is precisely that you and I might enjoy life, that we might have that pleasure, and it is a life that is full of pleasures we can barely dream of that he means to usher us into. That's what he means when he says, I've come that they may have life and have it to the full. It's that fullness of life that has purpose, that has power, that has pleasure, and finally, a life that has peace as well. A life that is lived in the confidence that with Jesus in our lives, there is not a problem that he can't handle, not a situation that he's not able to address. And therefore, no matter how anxious otherwise we might be, no matter how fearful we might be, with him, we're able to hand it over to him and say, Lord, you sort that one out. I can't do it, but you can, and I'm trusting you to do that. And he gives to his people a peace. A remarkable peace, being able to cope with life's problems and troubles. They come, there are sorrows, there are problems, there are difficulties. That's certainly the case, but he enables us to handle them all because he's big enough to cope with them all. And so, as I say, today's classic one-liner from the lips of Jesus is really all about Christmas, when he said, I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. And the they is you. That's what he means, that you and I should have that life that is pulsing with possibilities, pulsing with purpose, pulsing with the power of God, pulsing with joys, pleasure in the knowledge of him. And you may well say, well, so how do I enjoy that life? And the answer the Bible gives is not complicated. It says it's found in him. He is risen from the dead, he's alive today, and he's someone that you may know day by day, moment by moment in your life. And all you do is you simply say to him, Jesus, I need you, and I want you, and I want you to be in my life as Lord, as the one who gives that purpose, one who bestows that power, who will ensure such pleasure, who will afford that peace. I want you to be the one who leads me, who teaches me, who helps me, and I'm yours. And we simply give ourselves to him. And in many ways, that's really what the narrative of the Christmas story underlines again and again. The shepherds didn't simply hear the message about Jesus. They went to Jesus. And they went to him in order to know that message truth for themselves. The wise men who came from the east, they didn't simply hear about Jesus. They went to him. And that's really all that the Bible exhorts each of us to do as well. It highlights for us the fact that he is for real, that he is risen, that he is alive and at work today, someone that you and I may know, and it simply exhorts us to go to him and say, Jesus, I'm yours, count me in. There's maybe not much of me, not much to commend me, but I'm yours, and I want you to be king in my life. And I want you to lead me forward, use me, and he says, I give you that life. Later on in the Bible is a lovely verse where we read just this. The message that God has given is this: God has given us eternal life, and that life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. You're just kind of existing, and you don't have a life that is going to endure beyond death. You don't have a life that is full. You have a life that is destined for destruction. You don't want that. You want a life that is going to last, and that life is found in Jesus. So we'll close with a prayer, and then I thought we might, since it's Christmas, we might try singing a couple of songs. Yeah, there's lots of good lines, and the film What a Wonderful Life, It's a Wonderful Life, ends with the singing of a Christmas carol, O Come All Ye Faithful. Let me have a word of prayer. Lord, thank you for all that you are, for all that you've done, and thank you that you have come into this world, you declare, in order that we might enjoy life. And it's that life that we, all of us, are longing for. We long for home, we long for love, but we long for that life, a life that has purpose, a life that has that power whereby we're able to do things in our lives, a life that affords us that pleasure, and a life that is marked by that peace. And so as part of our worship this Christmas, we'd simply come to you, Lord Jesus, and offer ourselves again. What can we give you? All that we have, which is our very hearts, we're yours, Lord. And we gladly take this opportunity to give ourselves in this way to you. For your own name's sake, amen. Right, are you up for singing? Hands up, you're going to be joining and sing. I don't want to sing a solo. Okay, we're going to put the music on quite loud so that you won't hear me and I won't hear you. But we're going to sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and then we'll try O Come All Ye Faithful as well. Okay? Faithful, okay, you know that one? Andrew, you know that one? Oh, come on, you faithful. A little bit more volume, okay? Open your mouth wide, sound out the words of the song. Here we go. Okay, it's got a chorus, and you'll be familiar with it, I'm sure.
Oh, come on, ye faithful, joyful.